In this AutoCAD tutorial, I want to go over how you make the switch from a two-dimensional workspace to a three-dimensional workspace. So, if you've been doing a lot of drafting and annotation, the type of thing that this is going to be the environment that you've been working in when you're doing all that two-dimensional stuff. When you're doing this like construction documents and that type of things, but if you want to start making things three-dimensionally, this environment isn't set up very well. For that, so what we actually want to do? We need to switch to different workspaces. If you go down to the status bar and press by gears icon, we see different workspaces. And we have drafting and annotation selected. So that's what CAD opens up in by default. If I hit this arrow head down, I head down the drop-down menu, and you'll see that we have a few different options. We can do three-dimensional basics or 3D modeling. They're a little different, and then below, then we actually have the option to go back to the AutoCAD. Some features like save current workspace, like customizing new workspaces. When you switch to three-dimensional, we see how ribbon changed. We see dramatically different looks. We no longer have an expanded menu for drawing things like lines and polylines and circle and all that type of things. But we see that we really moved into this 3D world. We have 3D, three-dimensional primitives, such as boxes, calling spheres and the type of things, as well as tools to create custom three-dimensional shapes. This 3D basics workspace is relatively simple, and I think it works really well when you're starting out, but I actually prefer to move to the next one up just because it has lots of tools. I like to use readily available, so I actually going to the move to the 3D modeling workspace. And we switch to 3D modeling workspace. And now we see that we actually have a lot of same tools. There is just a lot more of additional, and like I said, I think one of just really nice, so you just dig into it right away, and there you know where everything is okay. So once we have this open, we're going to be ready to go. We're going to be spending most of our time actually on the home tab, especially when we begin using primitives and things like extrude and so on. But as we move and get more sophisticated, we might switch to different tabs, for example solid, to do different solid editor technical, next to that surface for surface settings, technique, and so on. As we get more sophisticated, we then start doing things like rendering, where we can add lights, materials, and actually create image of the things we created in at least a somewhat realistic fashion. So this is a 3D modeling workspace, and this is where we're going to start from. When you're working in AutoCAD, it can be very beneficial to customize the workspace that you're going to be using all the time. So it's set up exactly how you like it right now. I'm in the default 3D modeling workspace, and as it is, that work pretty well, but there are some possible changes that I could make that could fit what I want to do better. So it's a really nice thing to know how to do so. This is, as I said, the default space. So we have our standard ribbon and the command line below, and so on. When some people like to do is actually grasp some of these traditional toolbars that an AutoCAD classic environment might have, just to keep things available for them. So it's really common and very handy. Once you switch it from the drafting in annotation workspace to 3D dimensional for to 3D modeling, things shift around a little bit also, so it can be a little confusing to find this, and where you go, it's actually the view tab on the ribbon, which is about the middle in old version. But if you want to customize old tabs, we can press this triangle in the quick access menu, and press show menu bar in menu bar, find tools menu, and find toolbars. For example, toolbars with drawing elements. We see this floating toolbar. We see different command of creation of flatten images, flatten primitives like line, rectangle, and other. And we can dock this toolbar in the left area of this application, for example. We can customize ribbon element by pressing right mouse key, and we see different palette. We see different tab. We can switch off or switch on some of this, and we can customize this panel. If you want to create new workspace, you can use in main menu option command and find location of user preference elements. Or you can just choose manage tab and switch to customization tab command user interface, After you complete adjusting of your interface, we can save it like new interface, new workspace. All you can apply it to the current workspaces. We can switch, we can customizing menus, we can customizing palettes, and we can customizing access bar in this different workspaces. We see how we can change wherever you want or your own. You can use in view tab, for example, property palettes. When you select some objects, this palette show you all its property. We can use tool palettes and customize it. For example, we can customize it to find three-dimensional object, constraints, annotations, and other elements. And after you customize this things, you can save it like your own new workspace to your needs. We can press gear icons and save current and new interface, for example. In any time we can change it to 3D Basics. Or new interfaces. With all your preferences. We can use workspace settings to play around with that you see. For example, we can uncheck these interfaces and we don't see it anymore in this list. So I actually switch on all of these workspaces. If you want to delete unnecessary workspace, change it to right user interface, then find manage user interface, find in this menu new interface, right mouse click and use delete command, and this apply changes and press OK. We don't see any other interfaces. Press display workspace label to see what is current name of user interface. Another aspect of getting your workspace set up in an effective way for 3D work is using multiple viewports. Traditionally, when you work in a 2D environment, you generally work from a top view. You know, and then you might switch to different view. But generally speaking, you know you're working the one top view, you kind of like you're drawing on a piece of paper, well, once you want. To take 2D driving and bright it into the 3D world, you really need to be able to see that. We can switch from one view to next, but sometimes having at least two views available can really make that easier. It's a very simple process to do that. When you want to do is go in the viewport and press minus, and we see viewport configuration list. We can by default see simple viewports on this application. Actually, a variety of standard viewport configuration available. I generally use two vertical, for example. And the next one down, but this is something you can centrally play around with. So if I select two vertical, what you're going to see, all my screen divides in half, so I have two identical viewports right now. So I'm still the same driving, I'm still the same file, but it's as if I have two different windows that I'm going to be looking through at my driving. You know, if you want to select a different one, I can just come in and say maybe I wanted to do three. It will divide my screen this way, for example. Now, which viewport configuration you pick is really going to depend on the type of work you're doing and how big your monitor is, or if you perhaps even have two monitors, because as you can see here, if I try to do these three viewports configuration, my small laptop or big computer, that's not going to work out very well. So I'm just going back to the two vertical. Now, when you change the viewports, it's just going to do a copy of whatever you had opened to begin with, which is my case, happens to be top view wireframe. I can see in the left top view, in the upper left-hand corner of each viewport, we can see the name of view top and 2D wireframe. So if you want to do go and change in another, I can go on and select different views. We have a variety of options, so our standard option as orthographic view, top, bottom, left, right, front and back. This is orthographical view. So imagine that you have choir and you're able to see all six sides. Then we also have four standard isometrical views, and then we can easily see this parallel or perspective configuration. So parallel everything, of course, is going to be parallel perspective. Will be like looking through a camera, which will get to eventually saw a cold have a cold leaf. Maybe this one on the top view. That's something I frequently do, and then I come over right click inside other viewport to make it active. Active viewport, we see blue stroke in this viewport. Then change maybe this one to nose, like for example southwest bay symmetrical view. Notice when I do that, our axis line change a little bit. So on the left, in the lower left hand corner, we'll see that x-axis and the y-axis, because we're looking at the orthographical two-dimensional views, the c-axis is still there. It's just that we can't really see it because it's pointing straight at us. When we flip it, this right viewport into an isometrical view, what's happened? It's really kind of flattened out our view. So that here is x, here is y, and now the z is pointing straight up in the air. So as we draw, we're going to be able to see live how our objects is being converted from 2D to 3D to the right of the actual viewport configuration. You'll see that we have visual style controls. That's something we get into more in the future, but that's where you can change it from being a wireframe to hidden lines, for example. That's things like shaded all or aerial. They so they give you a better idea of the mass of something. What the materials might look like and the type of things, but that doesn't really change how you're working, just how you're seeing. It's not actually changing the object, just how it's represent on your screen. Okay, so the important thing here is that if you want to have multiple viewports on your screen so that you can see your model in different orientation, you just go to this switch and change it, for example, for simple. If at any time you want to change back to one, you can just come up to viewport configuration, click single, and it will expand wherever one you have active. Remember, as you work and you want to switch back and forks, I can just go there, change it again. You just click inside of the viewports. You just click inside of the viewport to make it active, and the border gets a little bit bolder, and that's the one you're going to be able to drive and manipulate it. Now I want to cover the basics of the 3D primitive works. Z3D primitive are going to be over on the left side of the home tam ribbon. So they are the very first tool in the modeling panel. So right now I happen to have box on top, but if I hit this little drop down, you see that there is a variety of 3D primitive shapes that AutoCAD will basically help you make. I find that I don't use them very often. I tend to start from scratch and, you know, make my own shapes, but this can be exceptionally useful for things like corners and pyramids and those types of shapes that are definitely a little bit trickier. So I'm not going to go through each and every one of them, but I'm going to cover the basics of how they work and they really stand for. So the first one, box, for example, will in fact help you create a 3D solid box. I write, so I am going to pick box and then notize down in my command line. It says specify the first corner or center. So you have some options. There is, I'm going to do the server on the right side of my southwest isometric view, and I'm just doing to kind of click. You know, towards the bottom near the origin point, no, I called actually type in 0, 0 to start this at the original point. But I'm not super concerned about that right now, so I'm just going to click and then I do that in case I just put my mouse out to create sort of an arbitrary shape, or I call type in C to make a cube. So be equal both ways or lengths, and then I can make something different. If I just do this without typing, it's give you an idea of what this is going to look like. So I can just put in my mouse out and click in this way. And we make actual 3D ones. I do that and actually end the command. You'll see that no is appear in my top view as well, so I'm just seeing the actual rectangle from the top, and then here my shape is over on the right of 3D because I'm in 2D wireframe. Actually, since through it is so, it's look like bit like on one of these cubes you learn to draw when you're a kid, but if I switch from 2D wireframe to something like conceptual view. For example, I'm able to see this is more of a shaded type of view, and see that it's actually, you know, a solid object, not just lines. So I'm just going to switch back to the 2D wireframe, and I'm just going to click on that and hit the delete key or erase it. So I can do that again. So I'm going to the grab to the box tool and once again specify where I'd like to start it. And now, instead of just clicking, I'm going to type L for lens. And type, for example, 200. And width, for example, 500. And height, for example, 800. When I place it, if I come down to the bottom of my screen, it probably be a good idea to turn into ortho mode by pressing F8 command. I'll just activate ortho mode when you create this type of object. So they get a nice straight line. So let's pull my mouse out, and they said, how about maybe this dimensions can be used. I can use the wheel on my mouse to zoom out, and they push and down the wheel to pan, so I can scroll out or in and pan around to actually see that's, you know, in my viewport just a little bit better. So that's using the box primitive tool, and you'll find that the rest of the works in a very similar fashion. So it's a cylinder we will be able to put in the radius. Of the circle, for example, so I'm going to specify the central point and then select the radius and arbitrarily draw or specify the radius. I can say the radius, for example, 1000, and height 2000, for example, and then press enter key. So each of the primitives have you know, slightly different way of putting the number, but the idea for each one is going to be the same. So we just need to read the command line and type in the numbers that you're interested in. If you're going to be creating three-dimensional model from scratch and not using the primitives that we see over on the left, you need to understand the difference between creating things with lines or polylines. The outcome that you get is very different. So what I'm going to do из Jazzdrava Couple of Shape in the top view. So, first of all, we create two vertical layout and so switch to the matrix. Wait. So, over on the left side I have a top view. I'm just going to grab the line command, activate line command, activate auto mode, activate object snap tracking and object snap, press first point, and make lens 1000 and close C command to create this equals rectangle. Functionally I really like to have on the I'm going to comment over and I'm just going to now do a simple square. This square might out of individual line. Now if you want to do another one with a polyline, I'm just going to come back to my top view. And create another square with polyline in the same way. If your central mouse button not work properly, to use pan tool, we can use navigation panel pan tool, for example, or you can use right mouse click and from drop down menu find pan tool to navigate. Escape to exit from this command. And again, we have a polyline and then we have four individual lines. Okay, now once you have, you know, closed shapes like this and you want to make them 3D, the first way you can go about that is so use extrude. So extrude is going to be in our home tab under the modeling section, and in the first one on the top we went over 3D primitive and then we command C that there is extrude, loft and revolve and sweep. So we are going to be our most common tools, we're going it's extrude. With extrude I am in my isometric view right now. What we're going to do is select the objects that we would like to take from 2D to 3D. I'm use one more time crossing to select object to extrude. After select all object, press enter key and select height. For example, 2000. Press enter key. I am again use extrude command and select next rectangle created from polyline. So we just pressed on it and one more time change heights to 2000. We see some difference wireframe from first shape and this clear element. Change visual style from concept 2D to conceptual, and we see the difference between these two shapes, two three-dimensional elements. You'll see that it looks quite different. Now we have surfaces versus a solid. On the left with my individual lines, I've done is basically pull up four surfaces so they have no thickness, but you called almost kind of things of it as like the you know individual pieces of paper, something they very very thin, and then on the right when we used a closed shape made out of a polyline, it was all joined together. We get a solid and they act very differently, and you can do different things with them and to them. So it's surface versus a solid, and if I'm just, you know, kind of orbit around, a little bit you will be able to see inside the move around of your 3D space. If you come and pick orbit, and that is my navigator bar orbit, or I can type in 3D orbit. I change it to the metric standard view, to two-dimensional wireframe. When you extrude, you must know what kind of products you're going to get, right? So for a lot of what we're going to be doing early, not going to be solid work, we need to have that closed polyline. Now if you drew a shape, you know, because it could centrally be much more complicated than just a box, don't forget then you can join it together. If you had taken a line, you know, I'm going 5 by 5 and another, for example, line 500. You must select all of this line and use join command from modify, and we create a solid shape from this object. Don't forget about them and remember the difference between line and polyline. Line and polylines, it's like surface and solid shape from extrude command. The extrusion command has quite a few different options with it, and I like to cover, you know, basically how this work. So I have my top orthographic view here on the left and my isometric view on the right. They're both in wireframe, and I have Ortho and object snap activated, switch on. I'm going to do just in the top view drone some very simple shape, then we can extrude and kind of play around with. I'm just going to grab the, actually I might just grab to the line tool and create some shape. And I create some circle with midpoint. And like this. So next I'm use for example trim command. To delete this. Once we have that, what I'm actually going to do is just gonna zoom out there a little bit and just make a couple of copies. Just you can see in difference. I grab copy, select. Sorry, I forget unite this element. Select, modify join, and then copy it. Select, enter. Point of copying. One copy, two copy, three copy. And we can see in the metric view. First of all, we just select extrude command, extrude first shape. And we have a three-dimensional shape, and it was very easy. We can change visual style to conceptual, we can use orbit to see this solid, not surface model. Change it to original state. Next, one more time use extrude command, select. Select second shape, press enter, and we can extrude in different direction this kind of object. But notice down at the command line, now notice down at the command line, you know, besides you typing in the heights, you have some other option, including which direction we want to go, you know, up and down. But we can also do a pass or tape angle, so maybe this one I'll type in T because it capitalized, and blue, T enter. And you can actually specify an angle, so it is not just going up straight, but we can actually, you know, type in some angle measurement. So I could say maybe I'll do, you know, 10, enter. So it's going 10 degrees, just that you know it has little bit of different shape to it, and then maybe I'll have it go up. You know, after that just use orbit and sweep around so you see that instead of going up perfectly straight at the previous example, you know, this one is curving a little bit, getting a little bit more in that, you know, like pyramid type of shape, and this just the taper angle, so we can create some very different effects. That way I'm going to reset my view to isometric, and then finally our other option was a pass. So we can do is actually create unique pass to extrude along. I'm just going to come in, create pass with line or 3D polyline. Don't forget, after you create the pass, unite all of these elements together. To create one shape. So after that we activate extrude command, select this shape, then press enter. But next we change mode to pass type P and select extrusion pass. Select this united lines. And we obtain these complicated shapes, three-dimensional object. Basis of using of the loft command. If you look on our home tab, we covered extrude. And now below that we have the loft. Now what loft does? It put either a solid or a surface that connected between different cross sections. So you can really create some very unique organic types of shape pretty easy with the loft tool. I'm going to do is just start in the top view and create a couple very simple shapes, and we can demonstrate these tools with soul. The first I'm going to do, just grab my polyline and make a rectangle on the top view. After that, I create some circles. One. Two. Three. And four. Then in the isometric view, activate ortho mode and just move in different haze with move command. select object point of moving and heights. And one more time. In the metric view we see a different heights of this line, but I'm mistaken in this circle and put it inside of this rectangle in the after that activate loft command and see notice in the command line select cross section in lofting order or point or join multiple edges or mod. So the order is a very important thing for this way we first select this select move command and change heights of this circle. Activate loft again, select this, then first rectangle, then second rectangle, then third, then fourth. We see this very complicated shapes was created. At that time we can choose accept this of you no, or I can go and actually change the setting. When you press enter you can see this dialog menu and we can choose settings menu. We can vary surface control at cross section. We can change it to ruled surface. If you have choose this you see how it changed. It's very sharp and then if we do smooth fit it actually does a nice smooth transition from the first cross section, which is a small circle, to the next large size. Went and then down to that rectangle you can also change it to normal. End cross section, start and end cross section, and all cross sections. In terms of how this is going to change, you know, change different draft angles, the beginning and the end, the magnitude, so you can see that you can actually do a lot of customization here. What I want to do in maybe just keep it simple. I'll just do a smooth fit and then I'm going to say OK. And now I created a 3D solid using loft. That's a much more interesting shape that I would have been able to make with, you know, extrude or something like that. And if I spin around, you'll see that, you know, getting something. Something pretty unique has, and once again I'm looking at that conceptual view. If I had to change it to wireframe, for example, I get something like looks. So that's the basics of how you use loft with cross section. The revolve command. The revolve command is going to do its start perhaps in the top view, and the real important thing here with revolve, and that's these tools right here, in that we are going to be the making a solid or surface that wraps around, revolves around the central axis line. And this really the important things here with revolve. What I'm going to do is start in the top view and use my line command, and I'm just going to draft that axis line. You actually don't have to draw it physically, but I think it's really helpful, especially when you first start using the tool. So I'm just going to click and make a straight vertical line on my top view. That's maybe like this. And I select property panel and change its color to yellow, for example. And right now I'm lying flat on the ground, if you will. I could be driving this in a different orientation if I wanted strength up or something, but for right now that's I do, so that going to be my access line. Then I revolve around, now I can draw basically in any shape that I was interested in here. So I'm just going to pan over a little bit, and if I just grab line, you know, I can't use object snap to snap to the also it does not have to have connected to that line. If I could come out and just start drawing some sort of profiles, so I might come shape like this. This line, and I create circle with two point first point, second point, use trim command to delete like this way. So I'm copying this shape with axis line using copy command like this, and one more time, we can use first to make surface, second to make solid object. So I can unite this by join command. After that I'm copying this one more time. So first of all we can use revolve command, select all line except axis, then press enter and select first and second point of u-axis and select angle. By default we see 360 degrees. By pressing enter key we apply these angles. One more time use revolve command, select shape, select axis and press enter, and we do it again, but in this way. Change degrees to 80 and one more time. Degrees. Change your conceptual view visual style from wireframe to conceptual view, and using orbit command we see difference between solid and surface element. Visually we don't see any difference with closed shape, but in these shapes we can see how it changes. It depends what you're wanting to do with it. If you're going to want to do any, you know, boolean operation to this or anything like that, but at this point we create some nice revolved objects. They are symmetrical around the central axis line. Basics of how this sweep tool works. So sweep is going to be found at the bottom of this menu in the home tab. So we don't extrude loft to revolve, and now we have sweep. It's somewhat similar to doing an extrude on a path. You know, it's the same kind of idea, and it can be really, really useful, and it's actually very easy to use. We're going to be doing this. Just going to draw very simple path to illustrate how this works, and I'm just going to do in my top view, and that I'm going to just you know, this point use line to create a very simple path for example something like this. I'm create two point circle with streamlines this and we unite by using join command this element. And to using profile I am use two different circles. For example, something like that. One more time. And use stream commands. And unite by join command. So use sweep command, select object to sweep, then press enter, then select sweep path. In the metric view we can see this path with this profile. When I start my shape was lying on the ground and now flip it and just sweep it along the path. That's really nice about this. It's a bit more forgiving than extruding on a path. When you extrude on path the profile and the path need to be perpendicular for to work properly with sweep. They can be the same orientation, it is, and it will just shoot along the path like that, so you have a lot of creative possibilities with something like sweep. Thank you for watching.